I want all of you to step up into the studio with me today.
Welcome to Popcorn Talk, featuring movie discussion, news, and interviews. Popcorn Talk. We talk movies.
All right, you guys, welcome to The Pointe with Kristyn Burtt. I am so excited about our guest today because not only is she the creator and the executive producer for Step Up High Water, but she also did Make It or Break It. And you guys know how much I love gymnastics. You know if you're following my Twitter feed. So let's welcome to the show, of course, Holly Sorensen. How are you?
I am so happy to be here. Thank you so much for having me. This is awesome.
I know, and I warned you about my gymnastics like obsession as
no,
well.
No, there is a natural intersection, and it's like awesome. The people that you know follow both sports. It's really, really, really fun.
How about for you? Have you always had kind of a natural interest in both dance and gymnastics?
Yeah, because I can't do either one.
Did you follow at least like Olympics and things like that?
Oh, sure. I actually did do gymnastics
you
as
did,
a kid.
Okay.
And I desperately wanted to be a dancer, but I grew up in Montana and we lived in a ranch in a town and like, ballet, like that was ridiculous. That was like the stupidest thing you could ask. Yeah, I might as well ask for like an elephant.
Right.
So it was something I was kind of longed to do, and I was not a natural gymnast, but I have a really big sports family, as it turns out, and I actually have two Olympians in my family.
You do?
Yes.
Winter or summer Olympians?
Summer. Winter. They just arrived. Katie and Sadie Bjornsson on Team Nordic USA.
I love that.
Super
That's exciting.
Fun. Yeah.
I love Olympics. Like, Olympic years for me.
Yeah, me too.
I am the girl who has literally, like, put, like, red, white, and blue ribbons in her hair and painted flags on her faces. I've not yet attended an Olympics, so it's on my bucket list.
Well, we wanted to, and I should have, because they were in the last Olympics, too, and, like, how often do you get that chance?
Right.
So that's really crazy of me not to do it, but it makes, you have no idea how much joy it brings the family watching, like, it's always great to watch the Olympics. And obviously, when I knew gymnasts, you know, from doing Make It or Break It, it was so fun to cheer for them too.
So cool.
But any kind of personal connection, if it's even someone from your town, someone from your state, like everyone in my home state's rooting for like the one Montana skier, like it's a nice thing.
It is. It's, you know, it makes you feel patriotic. I don't know if we feel patriotic enough in this country
you
sometimes.
You know what? Such a good question, and it's a good thing to feel right now, I think.
I definitely agree on that. Well, I you know, I'm so fascinated by your journey, you know, even just like researching for this interview and everything. I'm like, you have done so many things. You're like a journey woman, and then you here you are with Step Up High Water. But if I take you back, you weren't setting out to be a screenwriter. You weren't setting out to necessarily be in the entertainment industry right off the bat. Where did all of this come from?
I'm just a believer in happy accidents and fate, and I'm a believer in you know, we all think that we know what's best for our life and we dig in really tight and try to make that happen for ourselves, but I've come to believe that if you are gracious, you just let that go and beautiful things happen. I, however, not gracious.
Not gracious at all.
No grace. So I had to push my plan as far as it would go. Like, and if I'm still waitressing at 27 and I've never had a professional, you know, maybe there's a better plan for me. Like, I just didn't ever think that a life of a writer was possible.
Did you go to college and study writing or anything?
No, I studied philosophy. I got a scholarship to boarding school in Tacoma, Washington, and to college. And I didn't study writing at all. I just, it was like something I wanted to do since childhood, but it was just so far off the screen of possibility.
Right.
I could not even see that happening.
More elephants.
So I did everything I could until literally the only thing I was paid to do was write. Like I was getting coins out of the cushions of my couch to like get a can of beans to eat food. And, you know, someone would say, well, do you want to write this little thing? Like it was the only way. So finally I had to say, okay, well, I better start doing this.
Better start calling it a career, right?
Yeah.
I can do it.
Well, I didn't start calling it a career for a long, like until my bylines were in national magazines. You know, seriously, I was that stubborn. I just really didn't think it could happen for me.
So you were Montana, Washington, you went to New York at a certain point, correct?
I did. I went right after college and then I did a bunch of other stuff and I came back. But a bunch of really interesting stuff. I was I lived in silence at a Buddhist meditation center for a year. I was the
How do you live in silence? Because I take it you're chatty, because I'm chatty. I can't sit on a yoga mat for 5 minutes.
No, I could probably live in silence for the rest of my life. So like that part wasn't that hard, really. But I got to do other really fun things. Because life just bounced me around. Because I wasn't going with the flow. I guess I was.
It was your flow.
Yes.
It isn't necessarily everyone else's flow.
Correct. So I kept thinking that I was bad or wrong for, you know, oh my gosh, I'm 25 and I'm a bartender at Wrigley Field. I was a bartender at Wrigley Field.
That sounds kind of fun, right? Actually. At 25?
Yeah. So a lot of young women send me questions, or I used to be a film executive, so I used to go on the circuit to colleges and speak a lot, film festivals a lot, mm-hmm. and I always got the question, how do I, you know, what's the best way in, what's the best thing to do, and my advice was always the same, which is fail spectacularly in your 20s. Mm-hmm. Now is the time to fail. Now is the time to do whatever the F you want. I think that we put so much pressure on young women to be so perfect at such a young age, and men too, by the way. Mm-hmm. But that was actually the genesis of Make It or Break It was, I always find it interesting if you have a theme in a TV show amongst heightened individuals, like great gymnasts, but also resonates in the general population. And
yep.
What I saw in young women that I knew, my nieces, my nephews, were women who were trying to be body perfect, who were trying to do everything, who couldn't understand if their own path versus their team's path was the right thing to do. So those were the themes that, you know, I embraced for that show.
And I don't think it matters what generation you're from. I think yes, it's something we all go through. Exactly. How did you land as Gloria Steinem's assistant?
I was living in Minneapolis, helping Sandinistas get to Canada, like you do.
I lived in Minneapolis, and I did not do that. I actually worked for Governor Jesse Ventura on
did you
his
really?
Show on MSNBC. Yes, oh I was his gosh. Newsreader.
That's small world.
Yeah, well, Minnesota's a weird place for things.
I've been following Minnesota for a long time because I was a big Paul Wellstone person. And I actually worked on his campaign when I lived there.
I was living there when he passed away, sadly.
Gosh.
It was terrible. It was tragic.
Paul Wellstone, if you don't know him.
Incredible senator.
Yeah, yeah. If anyone feels like there's no ethics and truth and, you know, Mr. Smith is dead and can't go to Washington, you know, Paul Wellstone was a guy who had to buy a suit to go to Washington, and his wife cut his hair before his
We
inaugural.
Lost a good one.
Yeah, that was the worst. But the question was, what again?
How did you wind up as Gloria Steinem's assistant?
So I was living in Minneapolis, and I read where Ms. Magazine, which was an iconic thing from the 60s, and was going to stop taking ads. And in the media landscape we live in now, that is maybe a big deal, maybe not. At the time, print magazines survived on ads. So Ms. Magazine would have a feminist article and then Estee Lauder's new, makeup line. And they needed that to survive.
Of course.
But they decided, well, is our audience going to just pay for this? And we can get rid of that bullshit. And so we don't have to satisfy also their needs for editorial content. And I just thought that was such a bold and cool thing. Women can tell the truth about themselves, and we can tell the truth, and being a strong woman, feminist can tell the truth. They're trying to do that there. So I wrote a resume, and I was working at a, in addition to my Sandinista sideline, my side hustle, I was working in the mall.
I love your side hustle in the mall.
I know.
Which mall were you at?
The one on, not Halstead, the one on,
Nicolette Mall area?
Yes, yeah. Nicolette Mall.
Yeah.
So this Janky's store, whatever. So that's what I was doing. And so I typed up my resume like I was told to do as a good girl. And then you know what I did? I took a translucent piece of paper and I taped it over the top. And I said, if you want the truth about my life, read this. And if you just want the sanitized version, the resume is underneath. So when the resume said, I won this award, it was like, I really didn't deserve it because blah, blah, blah. When the resume said this, it said, my dean tried to have, you know, an improper relationship with me. Everything, I put down the perfect life that you're supposed to do in a resume.
And the subtext.
And then I stapled a thing on top of it that said, okay, this is the real story. And I warned them, if you don't want the real story, throw it away. Because the real resume is good. I'm a rural girl that got scholarships to boarding school and college and, you know, I'm a worthy candidate, but if you want the truth, if you guys are really telling the truth, I'm going to tell you the truth, and let's see. And I got a call the second they got it.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I love that. What did you learn from Gloria? Because I think it's so funny. I feel like, because she was so powerful in the 60s and 70s, I feel like we lost some of that. And I feel like we're going back to like some of her philosophies now here in 2017, 18. What did you walk away with from that job?
You know, I got, I studied a lot of women's studies in college. So that was great. When I was working in her office, she was on a book tour. So she was never around. I think I did get to house at her house once. And, you know, so I didn't get a lot from her personally. One thing I did get, though, is when I would go to events where she was at, and later, you know, at Premiere Magazine, I interviewed A-list celebrities. There's only been a couple people in my life that when fans see them, they melt down. And, you know, it's not just I love you, but it's you saved me. You changed my life. And Hunter Thompson was one of those, and Gloria Steinem was one of those, yeah.
Yes, Hunter S. Thompson. I did not realize this was you. I knew of that letter that Hunter S. Thompson wrote to you, by the way. So you wound up, did you go, let's at least create a little connect
You're
the
a
dots
linear
here.
Girl. Okay.
I love this, but I want to connect the dots even for people listening today so that they understand. When did you go from working with Gloria to, did you go to Premiere Magazine next? Did you start writing for magazines? Okay.
I went to Gloria, I was with Gloria, and the person next to me said Premiere Magazine is looking for an assistant. And I had never even heard of Premiere Magazine. It's so embarrassing. Like my track was so my track. And I was just I was a young person living in New York City, and I went and interviewed, and I got that job. And that turned out to be possibly the most spectacular, like, turn of events in my life. So Premiere Magazine, for folks that don't remember.
I lament the loss of Premiere Magazine.
It was one of the greatest magazines about movies or in general. It was a fantastically well-written magazine. The people that started that magazine have won many awards, have gone on to do great things. It was also around at a time when there was not, I don't think there's Access Hollywood.
Entertainment Tonight was around, because that started in the 80s.
Premiere started in the 80s.
In the 80s, 80s too.
So, but there wasn't Entertainment Weekly. There was no other press.
There was no E at the time.
No. So there was the trades, Variety and Hollywood Reporter.
People for the gossip
there
side.
There was People. But there was not a serious journalistic take on the business of Hollywood.
Yeah.
And that magazine also happened to be run by this woman named Suzanne Lyne, who, without any irony, we called the goddess Suzanne Lyne. So I had a boss who was stunning, fair, smart, shrewd. Like I had the model for the woman that I wanted to be, that I kind of, you know, other than my mother's grit and love, the kind of the professional woman I wanted to be that I had never had an example for. I mean, even Gloria wasn't that example, because she got fame so young, and she was so, you know, New Yorkized at that point. But Susan Lyne was out in the world slaying dragons, and she was hiring women, and she was doing this thing. And Premiere Magazine was so influential at the time that it was happening. Like, the line I always say is, like, when I was an assistant, I called Steven Spielberg for a quote, and he took my call as an assistant. Like, it was so powerful at that time.
Yeah.
So as someone who worked their way up through the ranks to senior editor, and I also wrote a lot for the magazine, like, I got to read a script before anyone read it. I got to go to the set. I got to talk to everyone about it. Mm-hmm. I got to talk to the marketing team. Like, I got to see how the sausage was made in such a deep, an interesting way. So, like, I call it my graduate course in Hollywood. It was far more than that. It was so fortuitous. And Susan Lyne still is a goddess. She's empowering women to this day. And
I love that. I love to hear that. Were you working for them in New York or in LA? How'd you made yourself to the West Coast?
I was working for them in New York, and through that job, I got moved to LA.
And then you wound up working for Shooting Gallery after that, right?
Yes.
Okay, because this part of the story to me is amazing. And for people that don't know what Shooting Gallery was, I mean, this was a really, I would say, influential independent production company at the time.
Super iconic, super, like, for everything that Suzanne Lyne was for female empowerment, Shooting Gallery was for male empowerment, really.
Yes.
Like they got on the map with some of the early, which we called then hood films, which were, you know, probably not a PC title, but this movie called Laws of Gravity, mm-hmm. By this guy named Nick Gomez, who's still a great movie. He's still a great director. Their big movies are Sling Blade, I think people know, or You Can Count on Me. We made little movies, and we made them fast and dirty. We probably made them illegally, and it was an amazing...
Amazing time.
It's an amazing time. However, the week before I got the job at Shooting Gallery, I sold my first script to Hollywood.
You did?
To a fancy agent. And I had a writing partner who was an actress named Tracy Lynn. And you might know Tracy Lynn from really interesting indie movies, and also she had a big horror kind of career also. But it turns out Tracy Lynn was also a brilliant writer. And she and I got a fancy agent. We broke up as a team, but I still have that agent to this day. But anyway, through the years I was working at Shooting Gallery, I was also a full-time working Hollywood screenwriter. So I made independent films for love, because they paid me nothing, and I wrote huge Hollywood films for money.
Hopefully I won't be coughing. Excuse me, but I want to get to the point of... When were you working with Hunter S. Thompson on...
The Rum Diary.
The Rum Diary.
Towards the end of Shooting Gallery's life. So Johnny Depp had a fascination with Hunter, and they decided to come to L.A. to sell a version of The Rum Diary. It's a really interesting book. It's really hard to be made into a movie. It eventually did get made into a movie, and... all the problems with the book are evident in the movie. But they went to all the fancy studios, but we wanted a shot at it. And the slot I got was to go to Johnny Depp's house at 8:00 at night to sit down with him and Hunter. So I did. And so I show up there, and they let me in, and it's this just bizarre scene where someone is constantly videotaping Hunter. Because one of his best friends worked on the end of his life.
One of his employees is doing this?
Yeah, a friend, employee of Hunter. I think at the end of The Rum Diary, you can see a lot of this footage on the DVD. And there's Depp smoking and drinking, and I'm drinking, and Hunter's drinking, and Hunter is making absolutely no sense whatsoever. Like, zero sense. He cannot talk. And then I'm looking at Depp, and he's looking at me, because he knows this is a weird scenario. Like, here's this guy making no sense, and I don't know what to do, and... And then out of the blue, literally an hour later, I mean, I guess you keep drinking, Hunter just turns to me and he says the most lucid and brilliant, like, 4-minute soliloquy. And then I turn to Depp and he's like...
So he has moments of clarity kind of thing?
And the clarity is fantastic. So he's like, Depp's like, now you fucking get it.
You're like, I had to wait here all night for this.
For this, yes. And then, so I've never really talked about this before,
give us more.
We went to the Viper Club, and then Hunter said, "I'm going to make up my mind who gets this thing tonight." And this was not a Harvey Weinstein thing at all. He said, "Come to my room and tell me why you want my hotel room, and tell me why you want this."
So you had to give him a pitch in the moment.
Yes, after a night of whatever. So we go to the Bellage, which was Hunter's place to go. He's his nom de plume was Dr. Feelgood, I believe. And we go up there, and room service comes up, I shit you not, with 4 beers, 6 red wines, 6 white wines, 6 glasses of brandy, 6 margaritas.
All of that?
For us.
Oh my gosh.
Yes, no, that was like it. And we had a chat, and it was funny and sweet and maybe slightly flirtatious, but not at all improper. And I left with The Rum Diary. But then I didn't make it the way you wanted it.
So there's an infamous memo, which you can actually see out there on the internet. Do you still have the actual letter?
The facts? I wondered
the
if
facts,
I do.
The facts, yes. Let's date it, the facts.
Well, you know, what no one knows is that Hunter sent me facts like that 3 times a week.
So it was normal.
Yes, and he was punking me a bit. He was totally punking me in that. So to the world, someone just asked me in an interview the other day, like, do you hate Hunter Thompson for being a bully? Like, no, I love Hunter. Like, between us, that was love. But to the world, it was...
You're like, holy cow, reading this out of context.
Yes. Yeah.
But you kind of had a nice little relationship, kind of like
We did. It was a huge, profound loss in my life when he died.
How did that fax get out there in the first place?
Because I think he CC'd Brad Pitt. He CC'd 10 people. Everyone in my office was so... I was driving to Sundance from Hunter's house. I was in Hunter's house in Aspen, and I'm driving to Sundance, which is starting, and my assistant in L.A. calls and says, you got a fax from Hunter. I'm like, okay, great. So what? Send it to the hotel. I said, no, you're going to want to read this
one. You have to read this one.
Almost, okay, read it to me. I'm like, oh, my God. But he CC'd 10 people on it. It eventually got to Harry Knowles, who had this influential website.
Ain't it cool news.
Back in the day.
Yep.
So, yeah, that happened. Yeah.
Wow. And it's a part of kind of like Hollywood history. It's kind of amazing. There's a lot of articles about it. I mean, people even go back. Like, there's articles in 2012, 2014. People go back and revisit it quite a bit, which is kind of interesting.
Yes. And he thought it was hilarious. Like, every time it got printed in something, he'd call me up and said, have you read Harper's Bazaar? Have you read, like, you know?
Guess what's out now.
You know.
I would love to ask, in terms of when Shooting Gallery went under, and I know you had already been doing your own screenplays and everything else, when did you really have the idea for Make It or Break It?
Another good question. So when Tracy Lynn and I were writing together, we literally were writing, we were full-time, very successful. I mean, as successful as you can be without getting stuff made.
All the time. And did you ever ghostwrite to it on any, or do any doctoring on any scripts too? That happens a lot.
Yes,
you don't get the credit that.
Mm-hmm.
That happens.
Yeah, so for people that don't know, like I describe feature filmmaking then as like, to my relatives at home, like it's the R&D aspect of the film industry. So for instance, Procter & Gamble will generate 300 ideas and they'll bring 4 to market every year.
Right.
Hollywood's the same way. They'll generate 400 scripts and they'll bring 4 to market.
That's right.
So you can actually have a very nice career being a scientist in Hollywood, which is what I was for a long time. But I was killing myself because my job at Shooting Gallery eventually rose to president of production, so it was exhausting. And I would drive to Tracy's house and we'd write from 9 to 1 in the morning every weekend. So I literally almost didn't have a day off for 3 years. So when Shooting Gallery went under, I just kind of physically collapsed. And I just had to have a come to Jesus about what I wanted my life to look like and my writing career to look like. And I decided I wanted to write alone. As brilliant as Tracy was, I just had stuff I wanted to say. And most of our scripts and my solo scripts were also romantic comedies, often featuring men.
Mm-hmm.
I like to write men. But I wrote one drama, and it was The Count of Monte Cristo with girls, set in New York, and it was called Revenge.
Love that.
And it turned out to look a lot like the movie, the TV series Revenge, but mm-hmm. no bet on them. But once I wrote a drama, I was like, oh, dramas are easy. Comedy's hard.
Comedy's very hard.
ABC Family, who I'd had several meetings with, said, come in, and they did the coolest thing, which is like, don't come up with a pitch, just come in and have a conversation with us.
Okay.
What kinds of things interest you? And I said, this interests me. Fashion interests me. This, that, the other. The Olympics interest me. And they're like, oh, the Olympics. That interests you. So, and I said, yeah, I'm interested in skiing. I'm interested in gymnastics. And they're like, oh, gymnastics. So I also got a blind deal from that script with the CW. And I was writing a music-driven thing with Lauren Graham's company. So I was busy. And at the end of the year, they have to spend their development money. And they kept calling my agent, send Holly back with that gymnastics thing. And literally, this is going to sound so awful, but literally, because I've been thinking about it and reading about it, I think a lot of work for writers, if there are writers that are listening, happens when you're not writing. Like, there's something happening in your, you know, different cortexes of your brain, even if you're not actually doing the work or doing the research. I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning and I wrote the pitch for Make It or Break It. I met with the producers at 9 o'clock at ABC Family, and they bought it in the room.
Wow.
But it was clear, like, that show just was crystal clear to me.
Like, yeah, you're like, I know exactly how this is going to play out.
Yeah.
I have to say, like, the run of this show, it was one of my favorites. Like, I wasn't a big ABC Family fan per se, but I was like, a gymnastic show, that's a destination show for me.
Yes.
And I think a lot of the other fans probably, you've probably heard that quite a bit. People were always like, as I said before I went in the air, I'm like, what happened to Payson? Because I feel like I wanted to know, did we get to, we knew we got to the Olympics, but we didn't get to go through the Olympics. Yes. That's the one of the things that has always been like, ugh.
Yes, it was an unfortunate pullout at the last minute. And it was crazy because our ratings were still really good. It just wasn't the direction that the network wanted to go at the time, which of course I respect it. Mm-hmm. Being an executive, I know how that goes. But the plan of the show kind of, like my idea, it just sort of happened to work out that every year they were going towards the goal of the Olympics. The next year happened to be the actual Olympic year.
Right, 2012.
The actual gymnasts were watching our show while they were training. I mean, it seemed bonkers not to just finish it up.
But, right, even just to do maybe a mini season or something
indeed.
Like that.
Yeah, or a movie or anything, yes.
Something, yeah.
Yes.
It's interesting, too, a lot of the topics that you were writing about at the time, and the show ran, what, 2009 to 2012? They are now very topical. And, how much were you, obviously the sexual abuse that we've been hearing with Larry Nassar wasn't made public really on the USA Gym side until 2015. And I think a lot of people have been catching up with that news, unfortunately.
And it's just bizarre that that was not front page news in every magazine for a year. Like, I mean, the whole year is topsy-turvy for a lot of reasons, but the Penn State scandal, the Sandusky scandal, was so devastating, but I think it just got so much more coverage than this one has.
And I think to make a really broad point on this too, we're focusing in on gymnastics. You did have like a molestation sort of storyline play in, which I think is really important. But it's not just gymnastics, guys. It happens in all sports. We've seen it with USA Swimming. We've seen it on recreation levels. And I think it's just been a great kind of eye opener for parents to pay attention to as much as they can, or we all need to be protecting each other and things like that.
Because we do, and I think that, you know, Me Too and sadly this molestation scandal is changing the way we deal with sport and changing the way we deal with girls in sport, and I hope boys in sport too. But, you know, the fact is there were parents in the room while molestation was happening. There's something about gymnastics that is so focused and so intense and so top down. And when I created Make It or Break It, I met with USA Gymnastics with men, you know, in a sport where there's very few sports where men and women play the sport and the stars are women.
Right.
And those two sports are skating and gymnastics.
Absolutely.
Anyone could see anything coming, and not that any of those people that were running the sport at the time were bad or wrong, but it just struck me as odd. I mean, we didn't come up with the molestation story out of nowhere. It just seems odd that there were a lot of men in charge of a sport about women. And I can say the same thing about the Miss America pageant and the stuff that happened there. Like, until we get some of this stuff sorted out, maybe when we are capitalizing on the work and the beauty and the effort of young women, maybe women should be in charge of that enterprise.
Yeah, it really... I mean,
there's a reason why, like, we tell kids in crisis, go find the moms, go find the women.
Right.
Right?
They're gonna take care of you and everything else. So I just think that it was really interesting. And, you know, obviously USA Gymnastics has not handled a lot of their cases even going back decades and things like that. So
it's awful.
So you kind of... You probably, even if you weren't like, okay, this is at the forefront of our minds, like it is in 2017-18, you knew. I mean, you probably knew that
there had
to be some cases that obviously sort of stood out in your mind.
And also, it's just such a punishing sport. And, you know, I love the sport. Like, I love the sport of gymnastics. I still follow it to this day. It's an amazing sport. And the one thing I will say, because I have an eight-year-old. I have lots of friends with young girls. They're focused girls going into gymnastics. And they always ask me, like, what about gymnastics? And I will say, the thing I know about gymnastics is I had Olympians, NCAA top competitors, and champions all working on Make It or Break It. And they're some of the finest young women I know to this day. Like, they are out in the world. They're kicking ass. They take responsibility. They live hard. They play hard. They are such special people. So, that is to say, like, none of them that I know went through those scandals, but like it's hard ass, but it has produced the finest young women I know.
Absolutely.
Hopefully we can find a way of meeting in the middle. Do you know what I mean? Like,
Yeah, I mean, because we need to support the athletes that are coming up, and I don't want, you know, everyone wants USA Gymnastics to just kind of go away, and I'm like, it has to be built from the ground up again, but we also need to support the current athletes that are in the program.
In the system, yeah.
Absolutely. You know, you've got Simone Biles even trying again for 2020, and I think she has inspired a lot of people, which leads me to, has there been any talk about a reboot or any type of that for any type of, like, even movie for Make It or Break It?
Only for the fans. I mean, because the ABC Family transitioned to Freeform, so all the hashtags are kind of different from ABC, you know. I don't even know if they know how much chatter there is about Make It or Break It.
There's a lot.
And reboot, yeah. Like, I don't think that they're, because I don't think they're even tracking it.
Yeah, it's like not necessarily on their radar because of that whole transition.
That transition.
Interesting. Yeah. I mean, and I just feel like the spotlight is on gymnastics, and it might be kind of fun to put some more positive spin on the sport through Make It or Break It.
Yes. When we did the TCAs for Step Up, I think it was the Hollywood Reporter who quoted me in like a tweet and said, it's time for a reboot of Make It or Break It, and probably not at Freeform. Like, there's someone should step into this.
Hello, Netflix.
And do it again,
I'm just saying. I was like, I mean, I feel like I get a reboot, like, notice every single day in my inbox, like, Magnum P.I. is coming back Party of Five. And I'm like, why not Make It or Break It?
Why not Make It or Break It?
I mean, Gilmore Girls, Amy Sherman-Palladino wasn't able to put that button on her show. And then she finally got that with Netflix.
She was my next door neighbor in Venice. We were just writing girls. Sometimes we'd have a drink at each other's porches.
See, and I love her shows, too.
Yeah, we lived in Altair Place together, yes, yep.
You must have some great stories, because I was like, I like both of your writing. Both shows that I follow. Isn't that interesting?
It's interesting. She's a great, you know, she's a great writer.
Yes, yeah. Enjoying her current Amazon show
as well. Oh, so good. Yeah. Ms. Maisel, and she has the world's best executive, Mark Restigini. So if you like Transparent, if you like Mrs. Maisel, if you like the Philip J. Dick show, like, there is one writer, one executive there that is just so good, and I'm writing a pilot for him now, so I can say that a good executive makes all the difference in the world.
Yeah, you need that support on the executive side, on the studio side. So let's get into Step Up, because I am fresh off of watching the first four episodes. I'm now going to be, I have to finish it, because I'm like, I'm so addicted. How did this come about? Because obviously so many of us are very familiar with the Step Up film franchise, which has been incredibly successful. And obviously for those that follow, obviously Channing Tatum and Jenna, this is their love story. This is how they've met and everything. But how did the series come about?
I don't know if I know the exact story, but the story that I think I know is that Eric Feig, who's one of the heads of Lionsgate, was at a Christmas party with Suzanne Daniels, who runs YouTube Red, currently. And Suzanne Daniels, in the past, was at CW. She was at MTV. She's always followed the Step Up franchise. Lionsgate owns it. They had a little chat, and like the marriage was made. And in fact, 10 episodes were ordered before they even talked to showrunners or talked to people's creative take on it.
And then, so how were you connected then? Did they have you come in and doing a pitch like, this is my vision of what it would look like?
It was a sexy job, because it was a 10-episode order. It was an iconic franchise. It was not necessarily a franchise I thought I wanted to do. Just because of Make It or Break It, I thought, well, I've kind of been there, done that. I had lots of other things I was interested in. I just didn't know. I'd had several meetings with Offspring Entertainment, which was Adam Shankman's company, because they were fans and their daughters were fans of Make It or Break It.
Yeah.
So I get brought into dance shows and sports shows a lot to pitch. Hadn't found the right fit. I was intrigued by this for the same reasons I just mentioned. And I just said, well, if I come up with something, I'll call you back. And I honestly didn't think I would. I said to my agent, I don't think this is for me. And she's
I'll
like,
sleep
you're
crazy.
On it. Like, you know, this is like a 10-episode order. Because, you know, for a writer, the heartbreaking thing is you kill yourself on a pilot. You throw everything into it, and it doesn't get made, or it does get made and it doesn't go in the air. Right. I haven't had that one, thank God.
But it happens a lot in the industry.
Yes. Yeah, no, I've been really lucky. So, but I just thought, you know, I just don't think I have any more to add to Step Up. We've stepped up, we've stepped out, we've stepped in.
we've done every single step possible.
But then I did. Things just started coming to me, like, fast and loose. And the thing that I say is, I read an article where it is a thing for a lot of Black sports stars and entertainment stars to give back to their old communities by founding charter schools in them. So P. Diddy is a school, and LeBron James is a school, and Pitbull is a school, and Will Smith had a school. So I just thought, what would the Kanye West School of Art look like? What if someone really dangerous and really complex, who had his hands in art, fashion, blogging, design, all these other places, because I didn't want to do fame. I didn't want to do the slamming lockers, because those schools aren't, that's not what's feeding entertainment in America anymore. Like, that's not real anymore.
Right.
I mean, it is for some kids, I suppose.
Yeah. But if you're in show choir, maybe.
Yes, exactly. But, you know, but most people, like, have a connection to the franchise. I mean, have a connection to stardom in a completely different way. And in fact, Kanye West has this thing called the Donda Collective, which is named after his mom, where he collects young artists and young graphic artists and young directors, and they all are in constant contact, and fashion designers. So the guy who directed the Fade video when Kanye hosted the GMAs, I think, came into Donda when he was 17. Mm-hmm. So, like, then all of a sudden, this is fresh to me, this is interesting, and that's what I...
You're like, I've got a direction for this.
I have a direction for this. And then I just thinking about it, They told me you don't have to bring any characters back. We kind of want it to be more like the first one, the first Step Up movie, which had a kind of an indie feel in a way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I have this background in indie filmmaking, so I wanted it to be indie. I wanted it to feel indie. And just looking at it, there were no Black leads or gay leads in a show about hip-hop dancing. Show about dancing and show about hip-hop, no Black people, no gay people.
Interesting.
So then I said, well, I'm not entirely sure that this doing this show is for me, so if I'm going to pitch it, I might as well pitch the exact show I want to do. And I want a Black gay lead, and I want set in the school. And God bless, it was Channing who, like, heard the vision and heard, like, other things I said, that he just completely backed it entirely. And
he understood.
Yeah, he got it.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
So you have Channing and Jenna and Adam.
And his sister Jen, Gigbot. And both of them have fantastic development executives. We have Lionsgate, who've been just fantastic. And then we have YouTube. And all so many incredibly smart executives on this. Because the thing to have done would have been to make a big, bloated, step-up, like, yay thing. And I think if anyone sees the show, they're going to see that's not what we did.
It's not. You know, and what I love, too, because, you know, usually dance films are two things. It's basically, like, two people from different sides of the tracks,
yes.
You know, and it's the West Side Story over and over. We see that in dance films constantly. And what I like about this is that everyone has something at stake, even sort of the supporting characters. There's something else at stake. It's not just like, hey, we're just like two people from opposite side of the tracks. We're going to fall in love, and then we're working up to the big dance finale.
That works
kind of thing.
In Broadway.
Yeah,
and I've said before in doing press for the show that I think the dance genre is a subset of the sports film genre,
mm-hmm.
and it goes a certain way. And you have to really deconstruct a sports film to make it a sports series. It's hard to do. I learned how to do it with Make It or Break It. We're doing it again with Step Up. It's not, you know, everything you love about a dance movie or a sports movie you're not necessarily going to get from a TV show. Because it's you know, it has to be character based. It's not leading up to the big ending.
Yeah.
You know, it's it has to be different. You have to hook them in different ways. So what I say about Step Up, it's not a dancing show. It's a show about dancers, and if they don't have anything at stake, I don't care. Really, I don't. Mm-hmm. So. And because I think dancing is beautiful and it's amazing, but, like, if you know, these kids' very lives are at stake,
mm-hmm.
you know, this opportunity is their only way out, so,
right?
Yeah,
through this school,
yeah.
too. I heard that you had originally thought about centering it in Oakland, California,
yes.
which has a huge hip hop community,
yes.
as does Atlanta, Georgia.
Yes,
how did it move from West Coast to East
yes.
Coast?
No tax credits in California.
That simple. I know. Yes. I always see at the end, it's like made in Georgia.
but I love that it's in Georgia. I've fallen in love with Atlanta, and we've just gotten some great press out of Atlanta. Like, you are getting the culture right,
mm-hmm.
you know, of Atlanta. Atlanta is super rich.
It's Hollywood East now.
It is. Well, yeah. I mean, it's the Nashville of hip hop, basically. But the people there are so about, you know, it's a festival culture and a football culture and. if you drive through Atlanta, like all the fences are painted, the graffiti's beautiful. People just start dancing. Like, you know, I tell this story all the time, but we had a power outage with 200 extras and everyone had to sit around for 2 hours and a dance battle broke out in exactly like 2 minutes. Where all the cast and all the extras dived into it. Like, it's just that kind of, it's a passionate place. And it's a place where you dance not necessarily for fame or glory, but you do, but just because dance is part of your life, which I love.
Yeah, it's coming from your soul, which I think is so important sometimes. We lose that when we're, you know, just dancing to get the paycheck. And yeah exactly. Excuse me. I have to ask about your directors. You had Adam Shankman, who did the first episode.
Mm-hmm, yep.
And Debbie Allen, Ms. Allen, did the second episode.
Which was amazing.
Those are kind of like great people to sort of set the tone for the series.
And then we had Rob Hardy, who did the second Stump the Yard for the third episode, Atlanta native. And then Janice Cook, who is in a fantastic, she was my producing director, so she was on set all the time, did both 4 and 5. So that was really, really tough. She did the Compton movie for Lifetime. She's a fantastic. Everyone who knows Janice loves her. For 6, we had the legendary Michael Schultz, who did Cooley High and who did Car Wash and who did Sergeant Pepper. Like he's an iconic.
Oh wow!
Iconic director. He does Blackish and stuff now too, but he has a background in big spectacle, and he was amazing. And all through the end, it was amazing. It was an amazing series of directors. Yeah.
And how about assembling the cast? Were a lot of them cast out of Los Angeles? Were you doing casting in Atlanta? Combination of both?
Both, and self tapes. Mm-hmm. So we cast dancers first, and then let them read. So we had many instances where agents would, and that's why we have so many fresh faces. Agents would call and say, like, so-and-so that you guys know is a great dancer. And we say, great, bring her to the dance audition. Could not last 30 seconds, could not last a minute.
Wow.
Like, these dancers are seriously good dancers.
Yeah, they're great dancers, but they're also, they're great actors, too. And they really have to be able to carry that story, because it's like, there's no BS in this, you know?
No, it's a very truthful situation. And all, not all of them, but many of them have come up to, and like, this is my life. And in weird ways, really is their life. So Davis is an R&B singer who's homeless. Carlito Oliveira, who actually got 3rd or 4th in America's Got Talent, ended up homeless. He's an R&B singer. Like, you know, it just happened that the people... I was going to say stepped up. In the writer's room, whenever we use the word step up, everyone starts going
like
that.
You're like, yeah.
So I'm inclined to do that. But Terrence Green, who plays Rigo, God bless, I love this kid so much. Like, we went out for dinner. Lionsgate took us out the night before we started Principal. He hadn't had a steak dinner at a nice restaurant. He took a picture of it to send home to his mom. Like, he's like, you don't understand. This is me. This,
like,
is who I am.
I'm getting a steak dinner tonight. Like, this is a big deal. We're like, steak dinner? But people appreciate that.
I know.
I love that you have Jade in there.
Jade.
Jade Chenoweth is like the superstar Instagram, YouTube. I mean, I see her videos everywhere. She's incredible.
What was so great is YouTube never said take a YouTube dancer. And they have lots of great dancers. Like, they just had to go through audition process. And you just look at her and, like, she's so special.
She has that charisma is, like, you just, you're born with it. It just...
She has it. And it's so... I was going to cast the Oakland version of the show, Race Blind. When I moved it to Atlanta, there were considerations that I thought would be interesting from a storytelling perspective. So the central conceit of the show is 2 biracial kids... leave their white mom,
mm-hmm.
and their dad is gone, dead, and they go to live with their black dad in a place that is overwhelmingly black. So they go from Rust Belt, Ohio, into Atlanta. So it's kind of this whole kind of awakening experience.
Yeah, it's a cultural awakening too for
them. Yeah, spiritual, sexual, cultural, like every way. So that's the conceit of the show. But the fact that if you follow the series, where Jade's path goes is really one of the best stories, and she just killed it. She just killed it.
Yeah, I love that. Because the first couple episodes, she's a little bit more in this supporting sort of the background, and then as episode 3 and 4 come in, you start seeing
she starts stepping up.
Yeah, the story starts emerging, which I love. In terms of choreographers, I know Jamal Sims did the pilot, yes. and then it was at Jamaica Craft continued.
Yes. So when we decided to move from Oakland to Atlanta, I wanted to really make the show most as authentic as I could possibly make.
Okay.
Because I really think that dance works in TV when it's really grounded. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, people are just bursting into song. Like, I just wanted to, like, let's make this not just about dance, let's make it about dance in Atlanta. So the whip
where
and the
roots
nay
are,
starts
yeah.
in Atlanta. There's a fantastic stripping culture, which some great dancing in the strip worlds in Atlanta, which we have in the show. Like, let's just make it really authentically the dance culture of a specific place.
Did you do any research on any of their strip clubs there?
Oh, yeah.
Did you go to the Belmont Lounge?
Yes, yeah, I did.
All right. The Belmont Lounge, people, is... I don't know. It's an iconic place. I will tell you that. It's older strippers. I just want to say it as positively as possible because they work really hard there. It's comical in some ways, just because there's a lot of, the strippers will bring people yes. on stage yes. and sort of like goof around with them and stuff like that. But it's, if you're old enough to go, you should experience it once in your life.
Well, there's everything from, you know, Magic City to Onyx where, you know, big deals get made in these clubs. Mm-hmm. They're considered, they're not just places where men go to. They're places where you do business.
That's right.
In a very serious way.
They take it very serious there.
So so that's a very much part of... We have a club called Velvet City, which is our pretend club that we go to a lot. Like, all kinds of dance in Atlanta is covered. And so I hired Jamaica because she's the preeminent choreographer in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And because we're strip up, we have a lot
strip
of...
Strip up.
Oh, that's a sequel.
I love it.
We got to interview everyone. Like, everyone wants that job. So that was really amazing. Jamaica wasn't available to do the pilot. Jamal Sims had done a lot of the movies, and he was off to do the Atlanta Aladdin Disney movie in London, and he just happened to have the month to do
that. Worked
the pilot
out perfectly.
And then we have a fantastic sequence in a party sequence that was choreographed in the pilot by Rich and Tone, who are fantastic choreographers.
The Get Down, you guys, yeah. on Netflix. Don't miss that. I wish that show had continued on.
Oh,
that was
God,
beautiful. And also, Savion Glover made that tap sequence. I
it's
said that
so
today.
Fun, huh?
It's so beautiful. Yeah. It's so beautifully lit and shot the way I saw it. And I loved having him in there because I'm always someone like, I want to see more of him. So I was thrilled to see
yes.
him in the series.
And he schooled us all, man. He just is such a master of his craft, and he's a fundamentalist about tap and the mastery of tap, and it was just a good thing for all of us to like, yeah.
Yeah, he trained with the legends of tap. I was like, I feel like he is one of those that is like
yes.
carrying the torch for that. I have to ask, and you know, everyone asks you this, season two, where are we? Have you heard anything? Any whispers?
No, I mean, the studio and the networkers have been so supportive.
Mm-hmm.
So supportive. And they, I just think YouTube Red is such an interesting place because, again, like, we could have been an extension of the movies. They'd let us reinvent the show in an interesting way. And I'm grateful that the reviews have come out so strongly
yep.
in favor of what we're doing. And everything they're doing, they're putting their own spin on it. They're making it fresh. So they've been great. And the network has been great. And so hopefully we'll find out something soon.
All right. I'll like throw my tweets out there to YouTube Red.
You do it.
I will. Have everyone else get on board because I'm like, you guys have to see this show. And
you guys have to watch it. You get the first four are free and there's a month's free trial for the YouTube Red.
So you can do that. All 10 episodes are ready. There, you don't have to wait. You can do the binge
yeah.
watching right now, which I love. I'm a binge watcher. That's
yeah,
kind of like
too.
My favorite. Any other, like, what projects are you working on next outside of a possible season two? Do you have anything else brewing? Because I love somebody, I love your genres, so I'm like, you know, I'm a fan.
I mean, none of them are, I have a sci-fi thing in Amazon, which I really, really like, and
cool.
I'm not talking about, but it's everything to my heart. I'm working on another thing about the state of politics in the USA right now, which
mm-hmm.
is really positive also and empowering, and talking to other producers about ideas that they have, and yeah.
Well, I love your journey, and I love your journey, how it winds up. I know you were saying
it's
like,
a winding road.
It is a winding road. Do you think that this will take you, like, do you think, like, writing is where you'll stay executive producing, show running, or do you think that there's another twist and turn ahead?
I think there's going to be another twist and turn ahead. And I will say, like, the thing about show running that's so empowering for me is I love being a writer. I'm blessed that I've had a long career as a writer, but empowering other people to do their job in a great way and creating a really great set to work on where people love to work. You know, I feel like my whole writing room, I'm raising young showrunners. I hire the best department heads and I give them total freedom to do their job. You know, I'm not the oligarch showrunner. I love you, you go showrunner.
Go for it.
And I just, the joy that brings the whole set and that empowering other people brings me more joy at this point in my life than writing.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there's lots of ways to do that in the world. So
we need more mentors. So especially in this industry.
Yeah.
It's good to be a good mentor.
Yeah, it is.
Certainly appreciate that.
I'm lucky.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. This hour went by so fast. And I'm sorry, I was like coughing. I was like, thanks for weathering through my coughing fit and carrying the story. I appreciate that. Where can everyone find you on social media?
Holly B. Sorensen at Twitter and Instagram.
Fantastic. And she's pretty active, so I have a feeling you will respond to people if they tweet at you.
Come at me.
I know. We love that. Hit you. And I'm going to fingers crossed for season 2 on this, you guys. Well, thank you guys for joining us here at To The Pointe with Kristyn Burtt, presented by Popcorn Talk and Dance Network. I want to remind you guys, we will be back next week, and we've got Dancing with the Stars troupe member Britt Stewart joining us.
Oh, that's
fun. We'll see y'all next week. She's great. I love her. Same time.
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network, we would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network. Views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.
I am the life of the party. Yeah. Watch me, old man, or somebody. Oh, man. Got my weight up on the block. Yeah. Watch me, old man, or somebody. Oh, man. I'm only better than me. Sheesh. Nobody better than me. Sheesh. They like, oh man, oh man, oh man. I throw that shit on the street. Old man in the morning, eating breakfast at the Waffle House. Old man in the morning, counting paper in the Capper House. Old man in the morning, eating breakfast at the Waffle House. Old man in the morning, counting paper in the tree.